I'm Ganna Pogrebna, and this is Data-Driven Formula One channel. We're going to discuss behavioral and data science aspects of Formula One. Just to give you a little bit of background about myself, I'm a professor of business analytics and data science, and I have done some work on Formula One. Particularly, I have written several papers on leadership in Formula One and on data analytics in Formula One. And I will be joined for this series by Patrick Hens, who has written books about Formula One. So we will basically look at how data science and behavioral science shaped some of the decisions in Formula One, and equally how Formula One as a sport and as an area influenced behavioral science and data science. So we will be talking about all these exciting issues. Just to give you some preview of things to come, I'm going to explain what we will be doing over the next year, probably, maybe longer. So we'll see how it goes. But essentially, this is what we're going to do. Okay, so with Patrick, we will be looking at the entire history of Formula One, and we will have some special sessions about each year of competition in Formula One, as well as notable people, famous drivers, famous team principals who helped shape the sport. We will also have separate sections within the channel where we will discuss data collection through sensors, how accurate the sensors are, and we'll also discuss important aspects of how Formula One impacted not only motorsport but also other industries, and how these innovations are related to data science and behavioral science. So with Patrick, we will start from 1950, but today I just wanted to give you an overview of the development of data science on the one hand and the development on Formula One as a sport on the other hand. So on your screens now you see the timeline from 1950 to 2020. So in 1950, we had the first Formula One race, while the competition itself actually started earlier than 1950, but we will look at official world championship, and this is why we will be starting with 1950. Well, in terms of the definition of data science, well, in 1958, we have the first definition of business intelligence by Hans-Peter Luhn. And then in 1959, the term machine learning appeared. Then in 1962, we had first attempts to develop speech recognition systems by IBM. And then in 1964, the New Statesman article actually discussed the overflow of data and how data is going to change the world. In 1965, US basically published the plans of first data science center for tax returns. And in 1970, Edgar Codd presented the relational database. So these were kind of the main stages of so-called driver as a sensor in Formula One. So this was a time period when a driver was the main sensor, the main person who accumulated all the information about the car and then basically translated this knowledge to the other parts of the team. The teams were kind of relatively small in 1950s and increased in size to professional teams by 1970. So we will talk about this in detail when we discuss each season. But just to give you some kind of perspective on what we're going to be talking about. So this is exactly how we're going to structure this channel videos. So like I said, the Formula One World Championships started earlier than 1950s, but we will start from 1950, which is kind of official date for the first World Championship, although races did happen earlier than that, like I said. From 1960 to 1969, driver was the analytical tool supported by multi-skilled engineers and mechanics. And by 1975, basically teams started to think about how to collect the data in Formula One more effectively. And in 1975, McLaren first developed telemetry, so collecting data about the car in IndyCar competition. And there were basically 14 different pieces of information captured through various sensors. So this is kind of the beginning of the telemetry. So McLaren is particularly highlighted in this timeline, but of course other teams have been working on this as well, some successfully, some somewhat less successfully, but well, essentially this is a major highlight when, you know, we actually had information on the track captured by sensors. In 1976, the material requirements planning, or MRP systems, started to develop. And then basically this highlighted the period of telemetry development in Formula One. And it basically was overlaid with such events as the first ever use of the term big data by Eric Larson in 1989, which appeared in Harper's Magazine. Then we also had from 1980 to 1989, major use of board electronics, introduction of electronic engine management. So various developments that led us to the development of early telemetry in 1990s. So in 1991, as you probably all know, Tim Berners-Lee introduced internet, which changed the lives of many, many people, including my life, and definitely changed a lot in the Formula One industry. So by 1996, digital storage became cost effective, and in 1997, Google search appeared, and this was the start of Google as a corporation, a corporation we know today. Right. So by 2000, we had various types of digital data, and in 1999, we also saw the introduction of the term Internet of Things. So what was happening in Formula One at the same time was basically high rate information flow from the car from 1990. By 1996, the flag stack became a standard for telemetry. And essentially, from 1990 to 1999, active ride cars were downloading data and streaming it to the garage. And more data was collected before and after the race, during testing. So all this data collection was happening at a lot of a more kind of structured, in a lot more structured way than before, when we had a driver as a sensor and telemetry development stages. And the year 2002-2003 could be called turbulence years, because we had two-way telemetry when basically you could transmit the data both ways from the car and kind of from the from the engineering teams. We will talk about this in detail on this channel. So very controversial period where you could actually basically communicate in both directions, not just the car sending the information, but the information is being sent to the car. By the year 2005, the standard ECU tag was developed, and we saw basically in the beginning of the 2000s, kind of from 2001, the development of big data as a term. From 2005, the Web 2.0 emerged, and the data increased in volumes very, very rapidly between 2005 and 2014. And from 2014, we also are living in this period, which we can call as rise of the mobile machines. So where essentially you have a lot of data captured on the track and away from the Formula One circuits by various sensors, and sensors not only surround us in the setting of Formula One, but also surround us in real life, right? In within the city, in transport, in various buildings. So all of this developed opportunities for Formula One to kind of develop mature telemetry, and currently big data, so-called big data telemetry or large data set telemetry. So between the year 2000 and 2009, Formula One relied on internet to stream data. So telemetry, images, all other things were transmitted live. Live analytics was developed. So currently, as you know, many teams are doing live analytics during the race, and normally we have an opportunity to observe it on TV when we're watching races. In the current time period, we see the development of cloud computing, custom-made analytics tools, which allow to run various live analysis on Formula One cars. And it was quite a special year this year, 2020, as you know, due to the coronavirus pandemic. We could not quite enjoy Formula One sport as we normally do. Data plays a significant role in this dynamic sport development. And this is kind of a way to think about the development of data and analytics in Formula One, from driver as a sensor to telemetry, to early telemetry, turbulence, mature telemetry, and big data telemetry. Just to kind of wrap it up, I want to show you this table. So in this table, you basically see all six stages that we have just identified. Driver as a sensor from 1950 to 1974. Telemetry development from 1975 to 1988. Early telemetry from 1989 to 2001, turbulence from 2002 to 2004, mature telemetry 2005 to 2012, and big data telemetry 2013 and 2020. Well, big data is a little bit an outdated term, but basically what I mean by big data is large data set telemetry, which is used in Formula One today. So like I said, the first time period when we had driver as a sensor was characterized by drivers feeding back the information about the car performance to teams after the race and during testing. In 1975, McLaren basically developed sensors for IndyCar, and the sensors were capturing information during the race. Various teams experimented with sensors all the way until late 1980s. So by 1989, the teams basically used patch telemetry, transmitting data from cars when they were close to the pits, but when they were far away, you kind of had this blackout zones where you couldn't quite capture any data. And in early 1990s, Formula One teams had high rate live information, but it also had blind spots. Like I said, I mean, the blind spots in 1989 were quite basically commonplace, but in 1990s, they were still commonplace. So whenever you had a track with dense trees or high buildings, like for example we have in Monza and Monaco, the information was incomplete, so you would have basically gaps in your data sets, so, and it was quite difficult to do consistent analytics, although it still was possible to do analytics because, you know, you did have information, you just didn't have the entire coverage throughout the whole race. So by 1998, Plextech became the major supplier for telemetry systems in Formula One cars, although, like I said, different teams were working on different systems. Two-way telemetry was allowed in 2002. This basically meant that, you know, teams could not only receive but also send information to cars remotely. It's a very, very controversial move, as you can see. Already by 2003, FIA banned the two-way telemetry, which I think was a very rational and good move, because indeed we want to see the driver's skills, the engineering team skills play out during these competitions, and we do not want to just see races with cars that are completely remotely controlled, or, you know, partially remotely controlled. That would be a disaster. So by 2005, the electronic control units tag 310B SECU by McLaren Electronic Systems and Microsoft was developed, and the ECU unit for all Formula One cars became standard by 2008. And then also McLaren Electronic Systems provided so-called ATLAS, which is Advanced Telemetry Linked Analysis System. This system became a standard in the sport, so many teams use this ATLAS standard. Although, you know, some teams, I mean, there is some freedom, so we will talk about the outliers, very notable outliers there, when we get to the year 2008 and the later years in the videos on this podcast. We will discuss it throughout the development of the series. And in 2013, if you look at the table, obviously the volumes of the data became really large. Currently, as you know, the Formula One car contains a large number of hundreds of sensors capturing a lot of data, and each race takes a long time to record in terms of kind of going through the data, and doing analytics on it is, as you can imagine, is quite a complicated task. Although, you know, there is a high degree of automation there. McLaren Applied Technologies also developed Data Viewer that helps with that, and there is an upgraded standard ECU, which the Formula One cars are currently using, and essentially this data-driven sport became even more interesting because it's not only the competition of drivers, but also the competition of data scientists who are helping the drivers to make the most efficient and timely decisions at high speeds. So in this video, we just looked at the overview of the history of data science overlaid with the history of Formula One. I hope you enjoyed it. We will continue this series by starting with 1950, the year of the first Formula One World Championship, which was the kind of the first official year, like I explained before. And we will go all the way through to the current year, which may be 2020 by the time we finish, or could be even 2021, I'm not sure. But essentially, we're going to discuss various aspects of the sport, especially aspects that are related to data science and behavioral science. We will look at driver's behavior, we will look at car behavior, we will look at the decisions of engineering teams, and we will look at various aspects of how data, behavioral data, and technological data, so data on car performance, for example, interact during races, and how decisions are made on the circuit. Thank you so much for watching, and stay with us and join us for this series. I hope you will enjoy it. Thank you.